I'm an organizer with Fat Beats Produce. I am the CSA coordinator, so I do a lot of the back end CSA coordination of our 150 plus CSA program. If you're interested, we have flyers and we'll be passing around flyers, always promoting it. And yeah, so today the workshop is freeing land for food. So basically, today we're gonna be talking about the intersection of gardening, food justice work, farming, urban greening, and gentrification. And we'll be going through what that word means and kind of unpacking these topics a little bit. So before we get started, this workshop is part of the Food and Justice series. So the Food and Justice series is a workshop series that we have every Saturday on anything from kombucha making to crop swaps to kimchi to how to grow your own starts. And then we kind of go into the more justice-based issues of, you know, food justice and the prison industrial complex and alternatives to policing. So we have a wide range of topics that we cover here today. And so today we're going to be talking about just one of those. So we're going to get started. Today on the panel we have Doria from Urban Tilth. We have Tiny from Core Magazine, Marika from Fat Beats Produce, and Ashoka is independent these days. So when we talk about toxic soils, pollutants in the air, asthma, and unhealthy conditions to grow food in and to live in, issues of environmental justice and environmental racism come up. So if you could talk a little bit about your personal and organizational approach to these issues, and how are you currently working to offset the results of these structural forces that produce unhealthy people and unhealthy food growing conditions. So Doria, maybe we'll start with you.
Okay, so that's a huge question. And it needs like a book to answer. But first thing I want to say that, so you said I was Doria Robinson. I'm the executive director of Urban Tilth. It's a nonprofit organization working in Richmond, California, just 15 minutes away from here. We are a resident, all of the staff of Urban Tilth are residents of Richmond or San Pablo, which is the next neighboring city. We are the community, that we serve. There isn't anybody outside of the community that we serve that we are. We are who we're serving. That said, I grew up in Richmond. I'm a third generation Richmond resident. I live in the neighborhood that I grew up in, or the next neighborhood over from the neighborhood. I grew up in my great aunt's house, three generations deep there. So Iron Triangle, Santa Fe neighborhoods, which is the neighborhoods that we serve. Moving into this question, Richmond is in the shadow of Chevron, period. Our soil, our air, our water are contaminated, period. We all live in it every day. It's inside of our houses, it's inside of our schools, it's in our playgrounds, it's on our gardens, it's in our soil. The question is, what do you do? Do you go somewhere else? Some people do, because they have the capacity to go somewhere else, and they just go live somewhere else, and they're cleaner and nicer, or whatever. For people who don't have that capacity, they're stuck living where they are. You know, they don't have the means to just get up and move because it's dirty where you are. And then there's this larger question of, it's a front line, right? There's something bigger, more wrong going on. And if we all run away from the places that are obviously wrong, who's going to hold people accountable? You know, who's going to say, you know, you don't own the air. You know, we all share this soil. And we're going to hold you accountable. And we're going to say, you know, actually, I have the right to garden here. And gardening here isn't any different than breathing the air. And I'm going to do this practice, period. And by doing this practice, I'm going to know more about what you're doing, i.e. Chevron or any other the related oil and gas industries. I'm going to know more about what you're doing than if I don't engage. You know, than if I stay in my plastic bubble of a house thinking that's going to be safer, which it's not, it's actually worse. I'm actually going to be more informed. Especially if you have organizations like Urban Tilth, and what we try to do is not just grow food, but also grow people so that people are actually understanding and learning and they're using critical thinking to understand how these things are impact them. So our approach has been to try to learn as much as we can about what threats are upon us, to hold the line against them, so we don't accept money for Chevron. We march against Chevron. We're on different committees to actively try to have a just transition away from petrochemicals in Richmond. I just went to Ecuador with the mayor to make an alliance with folks who are on the ground in Ecuador, indigenous communities there, to help make our fight stronger by having more people in it together. So our response is information, trying to educate ourselves, spread the information, create inroads, alternative kind of organizing in the communities, because the community is pretty much bought by Chevron, bought and sold by school backpacks and whatnot. And finally, to look for different things that we can do in terms of working the land to help, you know, speed up at least biological processes where necessary, so that contaminants that are biologically based can be worked through the soil. So that's our approach. It's not perfect, you know, but I feel like it's the best thing that we know right now how to hold a line and push back.
What about you, Tiny?
I am the poverty scholar, criminalized, racialized, and always in struggle to hold on to $1. I am the poverty scholar. I rock this attire because me and my poor mama did jail time just trying to stay alive in this holler. I'm the poverty scholar, the melanin challenged daughter of a strong black Indian mama, for without whom there would be no me. Ashe, oh mama. I'm the poverty scholar, a mama soltera and a welfare queen. Ashe. And I'm sorry if I landed all this spoken word on you, but I'm standing here with all the people who aren't here. I'm standing or sitting here in honor of a lot of our incarcerated peoples in these plantation prisons who are intentionally being fed things that'll kill them with deals with Monsanto and all of the other corporations spelled with 3 K's. With all of the elders and the folks and the babies who didn't make it, through what my sister brought up around the ways that corporations poison our air, our water, our food, especially as poor peoples, peoples of color, and folks who are not even able to understand or comprehend because we're so busy just trying to stay alive on these meager cash crumbs like food stamps, what they're trying to take down. Welfare, where we get criminalized because we do not work. It is not free money. We work for every measly penny we get. And so the struggle to just stay alive, much less figure out what our food is, much less comprehend the poison we're being fed. So, you know, a lot of us at Poor Magazine, I come from Poor Magazine, which me and my mama started. I did do 3 months in jail for the act of being homeless. Arguably, it's illegal to be poor and of color in this country, but it is actually illegal to be houseless. So we were sleeping in our car. I was raised up by a mama who was had been in orphanages and was disabled because she couldn't take one more struggle through these racist and classist systems on her broken back. And so I had to survive and I had to help our family live, and I started hustling on the street with different things starting at 11, and I had to drop out of formal institutions of learning and enroll full-time in a school of hard knocks. I don't say that as some, you know, pity party. I say that just to let everyone know that there are different ways and different forms of scholarship. So when I say poverty scholar, I'm talking about lived knowledge, not learned knowledge. I'm talking about decolonizing our minds collectively, that there is only one way to learn information, and that institutional-based knowledge is not the only valid source of knowledge. So it's first important that people get that. Because when we're talking about poor people's knowledge and poor people's in communities being gentrificated, as we call it at Poor Magazine, being destroyed by these corporations, we have knowledge. It's not like we don't. It's not like you have to help us or save us or feed us or pray for us. We have knowledge, and actually the first thing you need to do is honor that. The second thing is, me and Mama started Poor Magazine, which is a poor people-led, indigenous people-led movement. We're not even an organization. We're moving off all of the Jeffersonian terms, board of directors, all those bullshit. We did keep the 501c3 paper because that's a navigation. But we keep it very intentionally talking about the ways in which the structural systems of the nonprofit industrial complex actually work to take us down and keep us down. so we articulate that piece as well. And by any means necessary, we stayed alive through many different struggles, in and out of, I went back into homelessness when my mama was sick with the thing that took her to the other side way too young, which had everything to do with bad, fucked up food, bad nutrition, the lies about our bodies and our indigenous bodies and the way we're colonized in our bodies and poor bodies of color. But when she was sick and he was born, I was back in houselessness again, and that time I was stealing cheese from, or excuse me, liberating cheese from Walgreens just to keep us alive. And that's because on paper I had $5 too much to qualify for the fake-ass food stamp crumb, because that's how they do us. So I bring up my personal and my life just because those are all interlinked. There is no separation. If we're talking about realness, if we're talking about the ways in which poor people are continually displaced and removed, one of the things is to articulate the ways that those are connected. And the second thing is, one of the things we did is when me and Mama were sleeping in our car, we were in different locations being police harassed and incarcerated and all these things, but we were staying out sometimes in East Oakland on MacArthur. And fast forward 16 years, Mama had dreamed of a thing called Homefulness, which is a sweat equity co-housing model, but basically it addressed the way that how can we as poor peoples continue to be reliant on the very systems that destroy us. And so we dreamed of a landless people's movement and essentially a co-housing model without the lies of middle class co-housing and sweat equity and all those ways those have been pimped as well. And so today I sit here in front of all of you very clear about the ways in which our ancestors and creator and Orishas and all of our spirits have brought Homefulness into being. And so now it's out at 82nd and MacArthur. We're just land right now. We started our community garden called the Pachamama Tonatzin Mother Earth Madre Tierra Garden. And then we started the Garden for Trayvon, which actually was started at our youth, a Revolutionary Youth Arts Media Camp this summer, and the young folks came up with that name because of what of the injustice system had done to our young sons, our black and brown sons, to honor. And so it's an ancestor's garden, and I urge you all to check it out. But the crucial things that I need to articulate from the get, going back to the question we were answered, was there's a lot of elitism around gardening and community gardening. And I just want to ask people in this audience, you know, to think about the ways in which you might spend your time gardening to quote unquote help the community, whereas maybe you also have a trust fund or a paycheck or some other thing that you can actually kick down to some folks. And to start to make the, to openly dialogue about the ways in which gardening and community gardening has become this 21st century missionary service to a lot of privileged people who will now come into poor communities of color and act with this sort of arrogance and impunity about things like composting and gardening and greening as though it is what is going to save us. So we do a theater piece, because we do art and theater in every ways of poor people. We teach in a lot of different ways. It's called the Gentrification Garden, where we teach on the unhealthy enmeshment or relationship between the quote unquote greening movement, and I wrote a piece called the new color of racism is green, and how in many ways this becomes a cover for a new kind of missionary, and that's some bullshit. And I know a big love to Fat Beats for kind of trying to work through that, for inviting us in to keep talking about it, and for understanding your own privilege and access within that. Big shout out to people who are actually even trying to decolonize themselves from this unhealthy relationship and this unhealthy cover that capitalism sets up for people with race and class and education privilege or formal education privilege to operate without openly talking about their privilege. And how then that becomes more bullshit. So we have this theater piece that, you know, we'll come out and perform for any of y'all in places and spaces that you want us to. But one of the key pieces around that is, just to give you a quick anecdote, is in the garden that we've started, as a poor people-led garden, we don't even have the money for the water bill. Okay, so straight up cash is required to run the community garden because we're still living in a capitalist system where the municipal water district runs the garden and charges you per gallon, right? We haven't built our well, which Shale, we want to do. We're trying to move like Move 9, Long Live John Africa, move off the grid. We're not there yet. But we're also having to work with the politrickerism and actually work within the system in this weird fucked up way without pimping ourselves, which is very strange. Welcome to our nightmare. But anyway... That water bill costs money, okay? That beautiful dirt that Ashoka and some other cats brought, I always joke, I could have eaten that dirt. Let me just have the dirt for dinner. That dirt costs $500, okay? That's no joke. You didn't buy that at the gardening store. That's some money, okay? Yeah, and it's some, you know, some exchange and some bartering and some other relationships with other people who have race and class privilege, who have connections in spaces and places we can get it. Let's talk about that shit. Now we got this beautiful garden, right? We don't know how to pick the stuff. We don't even know when it's done. I'm a concrete jungle survivor. I've been long away from my Taino, African, Celtic ancestors who knew how to grow that. I've been damn well, my body is colonized. I don't know how to pick it. I'm like, looks nice, but... And then I get scared, you know, me and Mutiado and all of us scholars. And then there's the whole lie of permaculture. It was indigenous people's knowledge that was happily colonized away from us. And then you got a lot of now people with race and class and education privilege teaching it back to us. That's hella fucking crazy. Can I just name that? Can I get a witness? Oh my God. So anyway, on all of that, which we're trying to figure out, can't pay the water bill, trying to, then we're poor people, we've got all kind of hustles, right? So then you have to take care of the garden. So then we have to build an irrigation thing, but then we don't know how to deal with the irrigation. It's just an ongoing thing, okay? It's not easy, it's not little, and it's a very important part that is never spoken about. So when you're talking about poor people leading our own gardening, it's a whole nother motherfucker, I'm just saying. Right, and we want to name that, and I'll move on because I know my time's up, but I just want to say the last piece on that is the elitism of fucking composting. I know y'all think that's no big fucking deal. Let me tell you, as somebody on welfare and food stamps, it took me a long time to even have the energy and time to take the right thing into the right basket and like, no. Got people coming up going, I'll build a compost pile for you. I'm like, and then what? Right? And then what do we do? Anyway, everything takes work, concept, privilege. Let's talk about that. That's what we try to do. Sorry.
Do not apologize for that. Just woke me up.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
On to you, Marika, if you want to kind of answer the same question, what is your personal and organizational approach to these issues?
Okay. Just one more time, mad respect to that. Mad respect to both of you. But I really, really appreciate when people are real about what urban greening is doing, especially in the East Bay. So my name is Marika. I'm not from Oakland, not from California. I grew up in Illinois, a couple hours south of Chicago. My dad was a college professor. I moved out here to go to UC Berkeley, so there's a lot of privilege where I come from, and I've always had access to education and to resources, so I'm definitely coming from a very different side of the coin. That's the first thing I wanted to say. Organizationally, I've been working with Fat Beats for 2 to 3 years, I'm not sure, at this point, doing work with the CSA. Our CSA program, I won't get too much into, but it's a program that is the only program that Fat Beats runs that makes a profit, and barely makes a profit, but we make a little bit, and it helps to support some of the other programs that we do. And out of 140 to 150 CSA subscribers that we have right now, two of them are pay for the CSA through EBT or WIC. So you can get an idea, I hope that gives you an idea of who our CSA membership is. People that have the money to put up front $100 a month or $200 sometimes
at a time to pay for access, right, to healthy produce that's sourced from small farmers and farmers of color. So that's what I do, and I'm so internally conflicted about it. And it's just, it's like one more stone on that pile of like, what is urban greening, or what is supporting small farmers look like when we are trying to do the right thing, supposedly, but you know, it's always more complicated than that. And the people that are coming to us, or the people that when there's not a super dope workshop happening, that come to frequent the market, are not for the most part historic residents of North Oakland. So because we work in, or most of our work is very concentrated in these blocks, and because the gentrification and the displacement has finished happening, but has happened at such a fast pace in a very different way than West Oakland, or than what's going on in the Fruitvale or in the Mission, obviously, a lot of folks have already left. So it's like, who are we left with here? It's like people like me that have moved to North Oakland because it's kind of affordable, but it's not dangerous, or what are these other words that you use? Sketchy. You know, somebody's iPad or whatever is not going to get jacked, or their bike's not going to get jacked. And we have access to these plots or pieces of land or fixer-upper homes or whatever the hell we call them, to create space to grow food. And that's the process that I've been seeing in the 5 years that I've been in the East Bay, of urban greening. And that makes me sick to my stomach. So I guess the question is, why am I doing, personally, why am I doing work with Fat Beats, and what is the purpose of any organization doing urban greening work and also trying to do anti-gentrification work, or racial justice work or social justice work or whatever. I straight up do not believe that in North Oakland, in these blocks, that urban greening is going to have a positive effect, because I think that it comes with we have to recognize the material conditions that are happening in this neighborhood. And with that said, like, so the CSA is the prime example for that. But with that said, I think it's also possible to have other programs, do other things on the side that are directly combating gentrification, or really focused on creating access to people that actually don't have access to food, and are actually being directly affected by toxins and health hazards. So for example, we run a free produce stand on Mondays. This is like the easiest example for me to speak on, where there's a clinic that where our farmers market used to be before it got moved here, that's been in a very important part of the neighborhood for 40 plus years. And people come, it's a free clinic, people come from San Leandro, from Deep East, Richmond, to go to this clinic every day. And they're not from here, and they're not interested in coming to our farmers market. And they're definitely not interested in signing up for a CSA, but they don't want to be told how to cook healthy food. They don't want to be told about their situation, or educated, or, you know, missionary-ized, or whatever the verb is. They just want the produce. And so I think that we can do multiple things. I don't think that solves the issue of the problematic nature of urban greening. I think we always have to remain critical about that, but I think we can do multiple things, and we can be strategic about how we use the resources and the connections in the community that we have access to. What's up, Ashoka?
So yeah, my name is Ashoka Finley. I've worked on several issues of food justice and urban greening in different contexts. One of them being Urban Tilth, one of them being Helping Poor Magazine, one of them being Occupy the Farm with Marika and Hank, who's now involved. And so all of those are very, very different contexts, and so it's really interesting to have almost like a survey of these different issues and how there's interrelations and not interrelations. But I think that, you know, toxic soil and pollutants is something that we as a society deal with, right? Like it's a symptom of 20th and now 21st century capitalism, industrial capitalism, and the petroleum age. I drove here today, like that fucks with me, like on a really fundamental level, if I'm actually talking about like decreasing pollutants in the atmosphere and asthma, because I'm directly not doing that. But the reality of the situation is that we are straddling this system while also trying to create something new. And so thinking about the different types of limits and barriers and boundaries that creates for ourselves within the context of our organizing and our work is incredibly important. I do think that primarily the importance of what I try to do is using privilege to undermine privilege. I don't think that in my space that I try to work from, that I'm trying to create conditions where everyone, I don't believe in a rising tide lifts all boats sort of thing. I don't believe in that sort of style of economic materialism will solve our problems. And so for me, the urban greening thing is really problematic because it's hard, because I've been working with my uncle. He works in South Central Los Angeles, and they just got a bill passed by Los Angeles City Council to liberate parkways. And so what parkways are the strips of land between parked cars and concrete. And you know, my uncle and various people call this a like kind of food justice win, because they're like, look at all this land that we liberated. And like, look at all this land that we just liberated that's right next to the gutter. Like, look at all this land that we just liberated that is so incredibly not good for growing food. And we're calling this a win. I was like, why are we setting our sights so short? Like, why are we setting our sights so short? Me and my uncle were getting into this conversation, and you know, he has the baby steps mentality, and I have, say, burn down capitalism mentality, and we meet somewhere in the middle. And so the problem for me when we think about these things is that, like, fundamentally, when we're talking about urban greening, we're talking about land reform, right? Like, I'm not in the business of just taking the land or using the land that's been given to us, right? Because I don't think that we're going to survive off the scraps of capitalism. I don't think that's how it's ever worked. I don't think that's how we got to where we are. And so for me, I think it really looks like using direct action to take things when possible. I think it looks like activating communities that already grow food. In my work, I've found, you know, different experiences. Like, I have nothing to tell the Latina grandmother who, like, grows her own corn and tomatoes every summer. I don't have shit to tell her about urban gardening. You know what I mean? It'd be really, like, presumptuous to be like, oh, well, if you, like, interplanted, you'd have, like, a harmony of... Yeah, that shit does not work. Like, it just doesn't matter. She's been doing it for so long and has so much embodied knowledge from her culture and her tradition that she's doing it already. I mean, how do we create alliances, or how do I create alliances with hers to make it more politically radical if it needs to be, is a question that I ask myself. But yeah, it's different strokes for different folks. Whereas, like, you know, I'm a first generation American on one side of my family. My mom came from Guyana. I wouldn't exist here if the CIA didn't have a coup in my country. And so, like, having that, I don't have a sense of place like some people. You know what I mean? Like, I don't really belong here. You know what I mean? If it wasn't for fucked up systems of colonialism, I wouldn't be here. So it's not like it's it's hard, especially like I'm from Los Angeles, I'm not from the Bay Area. I went to school out here, so I have educational privilege, which I recognize, but I don't have class privilege, I have hell of debt, you know, I have negative equity. I'm so poor, like my bank account is always red forever. And so navigating that space is really interesting for me. And so I don't have creating community in the context of urban greening is a really interesting thing, right? So in food justice work, I've often seen, you know, we do something food justice-y and then we use it as a beacon to attract a certain type of community, and then we define that as the community. Or there's also, you know, the model of people within the community, and then they create their own conditions for material survival and sustainability. And then you have kind of the more like missionary, where like we're gonna go save these people and it's gonna be awesome, and we're gonna take pictures of their black children. I think there is nuance there, is what I'm trying to get at. I think that at different spaces allows different possibilities, and that realistically we're going to have to navigate all of them to move forward. Because for me, this isn't about food justice, right? Like that's not enough. Food justice is not enough. It just isn't. Like, if we're not talking about the means of energy production, if we're not talking about the means of like water conservation and storing, like you're saying, Tiny, like we need to stop paying EB Mud. If we're not talking about the appropriation of housing and land, if we're not talking about stopping police from fucking up our communities, if we're not talking about like providing healthcare for residents, and we're not talking about these in a holistic way, then I don't know if it matters. I don't know if it's enough. And that's a struggle for me, especially working, like I work in a context that's very much so siloed, you know? In the conditions and the constraints of our society, we are given different things in a way that just kind of placates the society as it is. Like as you were saying, Tiny, the nonprofit industrial complex, like, you know, getting grants for only one sort of thing, and they become very narrow and allow you to only do one type of work. I'm working on starting an energy co-op with some people, and it's the same thing. You know, it's like, for me, like, if I'm only like helping communities turn to renewable energy, but not helping them with their other types of sustainability, it's an incomplete picture. And so I don't like this distinction that we have right now. Like, what's problematic for me about urban greening is that it, and food justice in general, is that cultivates spaces just like this, where there's a panel and there's all of you, and we're the food justice activists. Like, that makes any sense. Because if it's bigger than food justice, then it's also talking about, like, the community-oriented social change, political, economic, social, revolutionary change. And for me, for that to happen, this panel doesn't exist. We exist in community as a circle where we create it in space. And so that's where I'm trying to move towards, but I'm still, you know, trying to pay my rent. So it's like, where do you have both of those at the same time?
Thanks, Hank. I know you missed the first question. So maybe if you could introduce yourself within the context of this question, but we're talking about toxic soils, pollutants in the air, asthma, and unhealthy conditions that we live in and that to grow food in. So what are you as an individual and within the context of the organization you work with doing to offset some of these forces that create unhealthy people and unhealthy food?
Okay, well, my name's Hank Herrera. I'm the general manager of Dig Deep Farms and Produce, which is located in unincorporated Alameda County. Just outside of San Leandro, the city of San Leandro. And I'm sorry I'm late. I'm sorry I missed Doria's comments, and I've never met Tiny before, but I was learning from you, as I've learned from Ashoka and Doria, and I've not met you before, so you'll teach me later, I guess, or something. I wanted to start off by saying, I won't do the Spanish, I'll do the English translation. The the Chicano activist poet Corky Gonzalez from Denver wrote a poem called I Am Joaquin, and it starts off with, I am Joaquin lost in a world of confusion. And I want to emphasize the confusion part, because as we talk about the contradictions and conflicts and challenges and opportunities, and they're all mixed up with all kinds of systems that don't work or do work in some part for some people but not for all people, it's confusing. And my entry into this work was about 20 years ago in Rochester, New York, where I was working in the lowest income community in Rochester, an African American and Puerto Rican community, where there were 100-year-old railroad tracks that went through the community, and there was black junk, tar, gunk, whatever it was, dripping down from those tracks, had been for years, and we were trying to do not urban greening. I could talk about my privilege or my lack of it or the confusing aspects of it, but I won't right now. The fact is that community of 2 square miles, 11,000 people, was impacted by all of the dysfunctions of our social structure and system, and it was much like West Oakland, subject to environmental pollution and toxins. And what we wanted to do, based on the experience of having lured a supermarket into the community which did not have one, is to figure out how to build a food system that we could use to generate wealth in the community that was, as I said, the poorest in Rochester. Again, I could go through that long story. It's a set of challenges and opportunities and paradoxes and contradictions. But let me just say, I don't believe that poor people have to remain poor. I don't believe that people who live in a poor community have to not own through whatever ownership means is available, and I favor community land trusts, own the land on which they live, the houses in which they live, the land that they farm. I don't believe that poor people should not or cannot own the means of production and exchange of their own food. I believe we need to build the structures, and there is space in the in-between spaces of our legal system for us to find legal mechanisms to do all that. But the challenge of doing it is incredibly difficult. And it takes partnerships we may or may not like. It takes grabbing onto funding we may or may not feel comfortable with. It takes a lot of stuff. So my response is, it doesn't have to be this way. I live in North Oakland. I live not far from here. I didn't want to see Northeast Rochester gentrified, and our solution to not gentrifying was that we would end up buying all the property. There were lots of abandoned properties. We never achieved that dream, but we wanted to put all those properties in our land trust, and there's land trusts that make it possible to build affordable or renovate housing to be affordable, and it stays affordable, and I won't go into all the mechanisms. We wanted to do that. What I want to do, some of you know Brahma Mahdi, and he and I and Gray Colofsohn, some of you know Gray, and some others have created a community land trust that called the Sacred Community Land Trust. Our goal is to acquire every piece of land that a landowner wants to give us an easement to, so that in perpetuity it can be used for farming, and not for the purpose of urban greening, and not for the purpose of further colonization by good-hearted folks who want to come and save us, but so that we control that land and we do what we need to do to make sure that our young people, our babies, have healthy food. That's the purpose of Dig Deep Farms and Produce. And just for the sake of full disclosure, so that anybody wants to hate me can, our biggest partner is something called the Alameda County Sheriff's the Alameda County Deputy Sheriff's Activities League. It's a private non-for-profit. It's like a police athletic league started by a sergeant at the time who grew up in Ashland where we work, whose heart is bigger than this space, who cares about the community, cares about kids. Some people don't like that partnership. I'm sure some people don't think anybody should work with the cops. probably don't think I should work with cops, but I do work with the cops because I have had a 20-year dream of doing what I've tried to describe to you, and the cop who brought me into that, Sergeant Marty Neideffer, is the only person of any stripe, any persuasion, any resource, whoever made it possible. So we have we started with a 3-acre farm. We employ people from the community. We're creating a worker-owned cooperative. We now farm on 9 acres of land. We grow vegetables. We're growing an orchard. None of that would have happened except for this one guy.
Probably.
So, like I said, think what you will. It's okay with me. The goal is, in this community of Ashland and Cherryland, another community like where I worked in Rochester, or like West Oakland, or like North Oakland, it's a community of 3 square miles, 36,000 poor people of color who have no supermarket, who have no access to fresh, healthy, affordable food. We have clean land. We grow our vegetables. We have a CSA. In many ways, we're blessed. Do we have struggle? Yes, we have many, many struggles. I'm not saying no. But I just am trying to illustrate my point that if we, as Ashoka said, it's not just us sitting here, but if we want to keep North Oakland from being gentrified, we have to seize the opportunities we have available to us to create ownership structures, community-based ownership structures, that allow us to control what happens to these houses and to this land.
Great, thanks for everybody. Thanks everybody for opening up the panel like this. It's been great. It's a great introduction to all of you, all of y'all's work. So sort of the context for why this panel's happening is specifically because a real estate company called Better Homes and Gardens has been fabricated a term called NOBI. Maybe some of you all have heard the term NOBI used. How many of you all have heard the term NOBI used? Did anybody say what it stands for?
North Oakland, Berkeley, Emeryville.
North Oakland, Berkeley, Emeryville, right? So this company has been trying to sell the NOBI neighborhood to people coming from San Francisco. How do we know that? Because the logo has the Bay Bridge on it. And there's no bridges that look like that in this area. So they want to take people who are being priced out of San Francisco, not poor folks, just like middle class folks that are priced out, and to encourage them to come here. And in order to do that, they had to destigmatize Oakland of its bad reputation as a crime-filled area that many people have of this neighborhood, and call it a catchy new hip term called NOBI. And so in order to sell this neighborhood, they had to find all the assets that a lot of poor working class folks, specifically people of color in this neighborhood, have been working on in order to generate a lot of positive things in this neighborhood, including community gardens, specifically the Golden Gate Community Garden on San Pablo. And so they in their promotional video, and you can see it online on our website, they use that community garden along with this farmer's market and our garden on 57th and Dover in order to encourage people to move here, saying, look at all these great things you're going to be moving around. So in and of itself, gardens and farmer's markets are great. But within the context of a rapidly gentrifying neighborhood and a real estate company that doesn't really care about the people of this community, they just want to sell homes, that's when it becomes tricky, and that's when we have to look at the problematic aspects of urban greening, community gardens, and farmers markets. So I'm going to toss out this question to everybody, and whoever feels most encouraged to speak on it can. When we talk about community gardens, there's a lot of idealistic, romantic images of it that kind of pop into my mind. And while they're potentially empowering and a creator of healthy food access, they don't necessarily always look at the deeper fundamental causes of the lack of access to healthy food, although they're a really good first step in addressing those. So, but as we see that in a lot of new developments, there's gardens and the real estate companies are advertising gardens to sell homes. Why does it matter who the who in this case. So why do you think it's the who that matters when we're talking about urban greening? Or who started the community garden? Or who's involved in the process? Who's it served? Like Hank was saying, you know, like, who owns the means of production and who does it serve? So if somebody wants to speak to that, how gardens are caught up in the process of gentrification, who is involved in starting them, and then how do we free land to grow food to meet the needs of the community while avoiding the co-optation of gardens by interests that don't have the people's interests in mind?
So I really want to speak.
Please.
So, I get really kind of heated and really annoyed with community garden things in Richmond a lot. Because yes, anyone will come in and say, you know, I'm going to start a garden project or whatever. And it's going to, you know, this missionary kind of approach of it's going to help the people in the neighborhood and whatnot. When in fact, what I see, and I actually, so I have so many thoughts, I'm trying to organize them right now. I want to back up and say, one, I think we have a whole set of tools existing in this system that we can use in order to achieve different goals. One of the tools is the tools of a nonprofit. That is a tool. It's a tool that you can use. It's limited. It can't do everything. It's, you know, a hammer can't screw. You know, there's different things that you can do with it. With the tool of the nonprofit, you can focus in on the fact that most nonprofits, the biggest amount of money that comes in and that they use money for is to pay salaries. So if the people in that nonprofit that are starting the garden or whatever don't live in the community, don't reflect the people in the community at all, and maybe there's a couple of jobs for a couple of hours a day that go to somebody who lives there so they can take pictures of them, you're not actually with, you know, that 60-70% of the money that going into that nonprofit is actually not being sunk into the community and helping the real underlying cause, which is economic injustice. With the reason why I get into so much trouble with holding a line with Urban Tilth in terms of we hire and train people from the community to do the work that we do is just for that fact. Is that the only way to really change our food situation is to change our economic situation. People need work. For me, community gardens are a way to create jobs, period. The people who are maintaining those jobs, are maintaining those gardens, are learning, they're improving their own situations by getting access to alternative types of education that they might not have direct access to, they might not be able to get into a UC Berkeley. Not everybody on our staff has that as a pathway, you know? So we use this nonprofit as a vehicle to increase access to education, to increase access to funds, as soon as when we get funds, you know, literally 70% of our budget goes to pay people, and they all live within the community. And the garden itself is, the fringe benefits of the garden is healthy food for everyone that can access it, you know, whatever we can grow. Other ways of people training each other, teaching each other, you know, because there are people from the community teaching each other what you know and inviting other people in so that we can make knowledge resonant. It really doesn't matter if you've come in from the outside and dropped in and you're working in a community garden. You're not changing anything. You're actually perpetuating the situation. That is my personal opinion. I really don't appreciate outside organizations coming into Richmond and doing that kind of food work. It's missionary, it perpetuates the situation. I say outside organizations and I say outside individuals. The core of the problem is economic, period. If you're in there taking somebody's job, you're part of the problem. And you should leave. I'm utterly a part of my community. I don't just do Urban Tilth. I work on all kinds of things. I'm pretty, like, doing everything I can to support our effort to do eminent domain. In Richmond, people have heard about that, you know, fighting the banks right now in order to make it possible for people who live in Richmond and who are underwater losing their house to foreclosure, which is a huge scam to completely change the market in Richmond from an owner's market, which it used to be where I live in the flatlands, used to be people of color, low income, middle income people. Who own their houses, not big elaborate houses, regular normal little houses, and pass them down through generations, you know, like the house that I live in, so that people had land security. So I could do crazy things, and I don't have to worry about rent every month. You know, I still pay into rent because we have a family land trust, and that my money that I pay goes into the family land trust, which helps other family members sustain. So now, because of what happened with all of the crazy housing bust, tons of people are losing their homes. And there's a radical change, and speculators are coming in, buying up houses for cash, turning them into rentals, turning houses. You know, we're getting people in the community that you've never, ever seen before, who is just radically changing. So what I'm saying is that because I'm utterly rooted in my community, I don't just work on food justice. I work on housing. We've been pushing for a renter's rights bill and a rent board and rent control in Richmond, which we have none of right now, because we see the gentrification coming with LBNL and with other things that are coming there. We see it coming, and we're trying to put things in place through this kind of radical movement that's meeting all the nights of the week, and like we huddle up and we meet, and we've been pushing for the last 10 years. I've been in meetings working on everything from Chevron things to rent control things to land trusts for the last 10 years. So yes, my public face is urban gardens and food and da-da-da, but I have my hands in all kinds of other things, and a lot of people like me who grew up in Richmond or who are utterly committed to that place have our hands in lots of things, trying to move on multiple fronts to make sure that Richmond stays the place where low-income, poor people can live a high-quality life, or becomes that place, really, because it hasn't really been that in the past. So we have this vision, we're holding this vision, we're working on multiple fronts, we're not just in the food justice movement. That's our face. Blah, blah, blah.
Anybody else want to address that question?
I mean, I just want to second what Dorita said about specifically the aspect of community members saving ourselves. I think that can't be said enough. Even to y'all esteemed folks here, many of whom weren't born here, weren't from here. It's a really important thing to talk about that when you're talking about gentrification, which is what we call it at Poor Magazine. We are the backs of us poor peoples of color rooted in communities are in fact fucked. We're talking about, so it's not a joke. And the ways in which you unpack that or untangle that are really, really complicated, but they're also really, really simple. And when they get really, really simple, they start to insult people, or that's how that lands on people. We have a thing at Poor Magazine called People School, Escuela de la Gente, and the first thing we do, and that's for people with race, class, education, privilege, either one or all of those. And then we have our Poverty Scholars Institute, which is all of us helping each other become teachers and learn already translate the knowledge we already have. But in the People School, the first thing that folks are asked or taught is, where'd you come from? Who are your folks? And why aren't you home helping your mom? Okay? Revolution is not here with us right now. It's back teaching back your own colonization and decolonization to the perhaps white or mixed communities where you came from, where people are being gentrificated. Okay, there's a lot of work to do in Minnesota and Chicago and all these places where folk come from. It may not be as sexy and as exciting as Khalifa Sazlan or Richmond or Oakland or unincorporated or this or that, but guess what? It's just as fucking powerful. Okay? So let's start by unpacking that relationship to place and self. And then for all of us poor folks here, you know, like sort of, you know, going along in our humble way, a lot of us poor peoples are humble people. We're doing, like Ashoka said, we're already creating the gardens and the medicine. And like our brother Hank said, you know, we're doing whatever we can by any means necessary. I mean, making unhealthy relationships or healthy relationships with sheriff department, that's what you had to do to make that happen. You know, it is what it fucking is. This elitism of who you have to dance with is a really complicated one too. And that comes out of some bullshit missionary crap. Oh, I don't want to be dealing with that. You know, Horror Magazine only started because we got a little crumb from welfare department to do a bullshit welfare to work, welfare to deform project. You know, because I could just write this RFP and propose it and talk a lot of hustle and game and get them to believe we were going to be doing, you know, essentially what they require, which is reporting people if you don't show up. It's police tactics, right? We ended up doing whatever we were going to do as poor people, teaching ourselves journalism and taking the $18,000 of bloodstained American dollars and actually using that tool of 501c3 to actually bring ourselves up, okay? That's how we did it. But so I believe you navigate whatever systems you have to, infiltration to navigation. As far as this gentrification, you know, all these rich people, real estate snakes and gentrificators and what I affectionately call developers, they have their plans, you know, which they know how to do with their big expensive lawyers and all that shit. We can have our plans too, right? So when we're talking about taking back some stolen Ohlone land, a shale, right, we're talking about how can we create, as poor and indigenous and landless people has been taken away from these things, now being taught back things like permaculture and mass, how can we take back and create our own plans? So yeah, we are talking about fucking paper, right? We're in a capitalist system. Paper matters. You want to fight the pilot tricksters? They do matter. And like Brother Hank said, you know, unlike our landless people's movement, brothers and sisters, hermanos and manas in Chiapas, who we definitely follow, and our landless people's movement in Brazil and Shack Dwellers Union in South Africa, unlike them, our problem is in a lot of ways, or our struggle, not so much our problem, is a lot more complicated, right? Because of real estating, colonization, and development, a lot of what Sister Dorita talked about those kind of family land trusts and stuff, those don't happen with us folk. We're so easily displaced and dislocated because we didn't have those kinds of ways of talking about land. So the crazy thing for us is, I always joke, you know, instead of us getting our 357 Magnums and suiting up, you know, or our whatever, we're going into the Paula Trickster's office down at City of Oakland, wearing like a little fake ass suit, and talking some game to some supervisors who I will not mention, who come back at us with some crazy mess. Why, were you gonna bring crack addicts and hoes in that neighborhood? We're trying to clean it up. I'm like, where are the crack addicts and the hoes? Come on, excuse me, can I get a witness? Who are you talking about? I'm a proud member of the crack addict hoe community, and I am sane, and no disrespect, and not trying to make light of the way substances take our peoples down. I'm just talking real talk about what it means for us landless peoples in struggle to be navigating these devil-oped and colonized streets where you have fools like that coming up with nobie, you know? I mean, it's just beyond. So to go back to your original question about nobie, first of all, this is very complicated, but, you know, I'm concerned about the use and the abuse of, or what I see is the color of gentrification is green, the color of racism green, in that way that they can be colonized by the developers, and that is part of our, you know, gentrification garden theater piece. And to me, what it means is that you guys go into some deep work that might take a lot of time and a lot of energy, similar to all this beautifulness I'm sure takes. I know you guys work really hard to actually engage with longtime members of this community to start getting them to be the owners of these gardens. So it's just a shift. You know, it may eventually end up that it is not a Fat Beach project anymore. And that's probably the only way it's going to be safe. You know, and to go back to what Hank was saying about the owning of, you know, that's a deep piece. I mean, as far as we're concerned, nobody owns land. I'm just going to say, I might have pissed some people off because I do follow my indigenous values, this Pachamama. So we're officially taking our little slice of MacArthur off of the real estate snake books. But on the larger scale, that isn't necessarily logical within a capitalist system. And you do need to create the paper, I mean, you need to create the plans, and it will take perhaps kind of following that model, and also doing a lot of time-consuming door knocking and engaging and loving with our neighbors right here, and talking, going back to Dorita's idea about who are you, and have you actually lived here, or did you just move in last year? You know what I mean? So.
Yes. I wanted to add a quick thing, just for clarification purposes, and this is not meant to be to derail us into a side conversation, but does anybody, and please don't be hesitant, does anybody not know like a definition of gentrification or want some clarity on what that is?
Want some clarity?
Would anybody want some clarity on the definition of gentrification? Since we're talking about it a lot, and some people might not be familiar with it.
Why don't we define it together?
Sure.
Does somebody know, think they know what is gentrification?
Displacement of poor people out of their own community into by wealthier, more fluent individuals.
Are you giving the land to the higher gentry?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you can't leave the word gentry out of gentrification.
Yeah. So what does gentry originally meant? The rich people of the town?
Who owned land.
Yeah, gentry is the rich.
Oh. So stolen. Gentlemen gentry.
Yeah.
Stolen. Yes. It's better.
One thing that's useful for me to understand gentrification is about disinvestment. So in order to drop the property values really low to make it very safe, for new investment, outside investment, you have to have a drop in property values. And the only way to do that is to pull out all the resources from the community. And that happened during suburbanization, when all the resources went out to the suburbs, the freeways, the new housing developments. That dropped all the property values really low. And now, 20 years later, it makes it available for investment from outside companies and developers. And that takes place primarily through the housing market. Yeah.
Before I show that, just don't forget that suburbanization, quote unquote, was part of white flight during the 60s and 70s, starting in the 50s. It's not an accident, and it's very much tied to race and class. And this reappearance of the people who moved out is both infuriating and ironic. So anyway.
Yeah, Ashoka?
Do you
want to answer that?
I think community gardens are a really powerful beacon and spotlight. I think they attract people in a very palatable way to the issues of urban sustainability and food justice when they're done right. I think it allows people to actually work on the issue. In a way that they can get their hands dirty and see some like material benefit very quickly. Whereas if you're trying to, you know, change the farm bill, it's not the same thing. And I do think that it matters who starts the community garden. I was trying to help a group of high school students that are based in Richmond and San Pablo start a community garden. One of the girls, her name is Precious, she, there's a half acre lot right by her house. And she was like, yeah, I remember she came up to me, I was teaching at Richmond High at the time, and she came up to me and she's like, do you know anyone with bolt cutters? Yeah. And I was like, well, why do you need bolt cutters? Like, what do you, and she's like, well, there's this lot next to my house and, you know, I really just want to grow my own food because every time my little brother eats this processed food, he gets seizures. And that was like, damn, like this is the person, these are the types of people who really need to be starting these types of things, right? And we help them, like, I helped them organize, I help them ask different people to provide different tools and starts. And, you know, going back to the idea of toxic soils, like there used to be a building there, so there was a bunch of gravel and the soil wasn't very good. And there was the recognition that it was going to take a lot of work. And so we worked for 2 days, and then the city locked them out, right? And when the city locked them out, they organized themselves and went to the city council meeting and asked. They were like, why did you do that? This lot has been sitting here for years, almost a decade at this point. Nothing's been done with it, and you won't let us grow food on it. And the city's response was that you can't have it, it's owned by the state. Which wasn't completely true, because the city had offered it to another organization earlier. So it was an example of the, it's not necessarily who creates the garden, but it's also how the garden's created. Our system doesn't really want to give any clout to examples of models that are like outside the authority structure, right? We can do community gardens, rooted in community, but usually the land ends up being given to us, right? That sort of thing is accredited. That sort of thing becomes rubber stamped. And so I think the relationship between those two things is really important. And you know, a lot of people have taken over lands and created sustainable community gardens. And a community garden is a garden without a fence. I just want to say that. A community garden cannot have a fence. That obviously brings different problems and challenges. I know my roommate manages an urban till site called the Greenway Gardens, and she has to deal with people stealing plants. Like, people have such an appetite for produce that they're stealing plants. People destroy parts of the garden. People destroy different things that people have built there and put energy into. And there's a general time sink around having an open garden like that. But it also allows for things that aren't possible in closed community gardens, such as unmonitored access to the garden, like unmonitored picking of all the food that grows. And that to me is really actually kind of resilience-based community organizing. I think there's a problem with our economic focus. I don't think that the primary problem is actually economic. I think the primary problem is environmental. Because if you go back far enough, this land used to be able to sustain people. Right? Like, if we start our timeline a little longer, this land used to be incredibly fucking productive. Like, this bay used to be crazy productive. That was changed by the economic process. And so I don't know, like, I'm creating a co-op right now, like, but I do have reservations. Like, will I ever be able to create enough employment to make a difference? Like, I'm sure I can patch things here and there, and like, we're working on figuring out like job training programs for different youth in Oakland around like energy efficiency and different things. But I still, like, I don't have a job for their parents, you know what I mean? I don't have a job for their grandparents. I don't know anybody with a job for their grandparents or parents. And so I don't know, so it's hard. It's hard navigating this relationship, right? Of like capital needs versus sustainable futures, and how do we get to one without the other? Is it possible to get to one without the other? But I don't know, it makes me really frustrated, to be honest. Just like, it frustrates me the scale of what needs to happen versus the scale of what is happening right now, you know? And trying to find peace with the idea that it's moving forward and changing and like becoming more, I don't know. I think becoming more resonant with what actually needs to happen.
I want to say a couple of things just about land access and whatnot. And I think that looking for the partners that you already have in place, and one, being politically active so that the political system is actually you
you are the government is important. So you eliminate the us and them thing, and can move things in a more ready way. We get offered too much land at Urban Tilth. Like, people are saying, have my lot. We can't maintain all that. Like, it's too much, actually. Like, we actually don't. So I don't see the problem of land. I see the problem of us trying to organize ways where people can sustain managing that land. And not through volunteerism. I love volunteerism. I volunteer myself. I incorporate volunteers in our projects. But people, that has to be something that somebody does in their spare time, if they have spare time, and not something that you depend on sustaining things for as long as people have to pay rent, you know, and electric bills. Like, as long as people have to pay rent and electric bills, we can't think we're going to change the world through volunteerism. It's not going to happen. So I don't see the problem of land. I think that it's a problem of partnerships, a problem of making real relationships with people who have access to land. Like Hank was saying, you know, like getting down with whatever. I have deep friends in the city of San Pablo and the city of Richmond, and in people who own land. And they support by offering up their resource. And what we need to do is figure out how to grow these little operations so that we can sustain more than just the little operations. So we can tighten our systems so that they actually come back. And we need to get out of the mind frame and really think about, you know, just because we don't come from money doesn't mean we don't have the potential to gather resources. You know, my family land trust was created by a bunch of sharecroppers, my grandfather and everything. They didn't have money, you know. They actually got together with a whole bunch of other people and they said, we're going to trust you guys. We're going to trust you guys and we're going to take this $100 that I have and you guys are going to, and we're all going to put in, we're going to amass amount and we're going to buy one thing together. And then we're going to do something with that thing. And we're going to use that, you know, the resources from that to put people in that house so they're stable. And then we're going to amass our resources again and we're going to buy this thing together. And we're all throughout this process, we're trusting each other. And not everyone is benefiting at once. Only one family gets in that house at once. But then as soon as they're stable, then we can get, you know, whatever. And they actually did that over, you know, 60 years in Richmond and managed through their network of families to amass 7 properties, you know, and then use the equity in those properties to buy 500 acres in Fairfield and run a ranch. I mean, these are poor people. Nobody had savings accounts. Nobody had, hey, they're coming from Louisiana and Arkansas, like back country, not New Orleans, not like with, you know, nobody had degrees, but people didn't have high school diplomas, you know? And it's just like, you gotta think outside of the stereotype that's projected on us as people, poor people, that we can't do, you know? If, like, what we really need to be working for as poor people is how do we trust each other? How do we build trust relationships so that we can actually, you know, create systems where we can amass the amount of resource that we have to build from. And that's where we need to work. That's where our work is, you know. And then also, how do we get into relationships with people who have access to money and power or whatever to get other resources that would take us forever to get, you know. And I just believe that we can be the government that we hate. We can actually take those things over. And I've been in Richmond working diligently, you know, behind the scenes, actually, you know, helping to get people in city council, helping to get people in various, you know, working behind the scenes with people who have run the city managers and the different people, so they know who I am. And they know the work that we do and will, whenever they have an opportunity to, hey, there's this resource, there's that resource, throw it down to people. And I think that we, some of the ideals of kind of radical progressive movements actually, you know, cut off your foot, you know. They actually make it so that real people who actually need help can't get help for the idealism. It stands in the way of progress, you know. And so I just want to say that, like, it's important who does it, really important who does it, because that's resource, you know, and we need to be cycling resources in the people. The best way to help people who need food is to make sure they have money, you know, and two, there's hella land, and what we need to do is figure out how we can maintain that land in the most respectful way, both to the people who need to work it and for the land itself. You know, and not every lot is the great lot to work in, you know, and like we need to be making those choices and you know, maybe it's not a good idea to go into a fight just because there's a fight, you know? Like, I know it's sexy, you can get out, you can protest, you can get on the news, you can whatever, but what if you could just grow food? What if you could just do the thing that you wanted to do? You know, and somebody's saying, hey, I got this land, you know, but that's not sexy to you because there's no fight in it, you know? And I'm like, but didn't you want to grow food? You know, like what else is it, you know? You know, if the government sucks, be the fucking government. Or step out of it and just do whatever it is that you really wanted to do in the first place. Like, I think we get caught up in radical movements and don't actually move shit forward and then end up 20 years later, like, what became of it? You know? And I'm like, over it. I'm over it. You know? I'm actually in Richmond, we get so many people coming to protest Chevron and they never stop to talk to anybody who's here to think about what we need and what we want. They're in, make a big movement, and then they're out. And it's just like, oh well, okay, whatever. I think we need to think out of some of the normal boxes.
Yeah, and I think one thing that I hear everybody touching on is this issue of navigating contradictions, perhaps. And we have Hank talking about working with the Sheriff's Department, Tiny, you know, figuring out whether Poor is incorporated or on the grid, and all these things. That contradiction of working with institutions and foundations to get money to do the work that we want and that we need is a very complex one. And I think oftentimes movements get caught up in the issue of privilege, that we think that we're so radical that we shouldn't take this money or shouldn't work with this institution. When in fact, it's a very privileged thing to be able to say, we're not working with you because, you know, it's against our ideals and our ideology. It's a very privileged thing to not take that money when folks who want to do the work and who have been struggling and on the forefronts of these struggles need jobs and they need money. And the only way to fund their work is through taking that grant, whether it be from a corporation or not. These are things individual organizations have to figure out, but it's just, I don't think it's our role in the movement as allies, as organizers, to tell other people, hey, you know, you shouldn't be working with these folks because they're messed up. And maybe Hank has some more conversation. I see some hands going up in the audience. I don't know, should we be taking questions
at
now?
Something to what you just said. Like, I make a huge ass point of we don't take money for Chevron.
Yeah.
Chevron is a multinational mega giant. And what they do when they give you a half a penny, you know, they give you much less. Everybody always thinks they're going to get a whole shitload of money from Chevron if you're working in Richmond. They give you like $5,000 to $25,000 max. That's what the kind of grants people are getting. And in exchange, you can't speak against them. They come to your site and do work at your site with their shirts on. And as if, you know, and then they put it in all their advertisements and all their whatever, like, look what we're doing for the community of Richmond for this one afternoon. So you're sold. You're bought and sold. So I would say that, yes, you have to make uncommon alliances.
Yeah.
Yes, you take money from sources that, you know, money in general comes from usually from dirty sources, you know. But in particular, I say that you don't want to sell your ass.
No.
You don't want to be pimped. And that is straight. Like, that's straight corporate pimping, and we just are not having it. Like, not having it. You know, like, it's, I think it's a really different thing than what's happening with the Sheriff's Department, who are looking to try to, you know, think of uncommon ways to change. And we might have issues with policing in general and the Sheriff's Department or whatever, but they're not going to, you know, they're not going to be, like, you know, dumping 19 million gallons of oil in the Amazon and showing pictures of folks, black folks in Richmond, you know, how they help them and saying, we love the environment, you know? Like, you're not going to be pimped in that way. Like, it's not going to happen.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, Hank, did you want to speak
I just wanted
that?
To say, doing this work really depends on our integrity with our own values. And that just underscores, I think, what Daria is saying. We have to know what our values are. We have to have our analysis. and we need to stick to it. And I just wanted to add, the reason the sheriff's office is involved with what we do is because the sheriff's office has begun to recognize that arresting people is not a way to stop crime. That crime prevention depends on people having jobs, and we're creating jobs. That's our mission, is to create jobs and to create more jobs, just as Doria was saying. And I've heard really tough cops say, what we do is arrest people, what you do is crime prevention, and we're growing food. And I've heard the sheriff say it in public to his entire command staff. So it's not uncomplicated, it's very complicated, but in the little tiny interesting way, people will begin to shift, and it has to do with our values. So
I just want to say, I know you want, I definitely think the audience should be, or people should be talking. I just want to throw in that it goes back to the original piece, anthropology, ethnography, psychology, the study about us without us. Okay, so yeah. As poor folks, it's elitist to be saying we ain't gonna be taking this, and then except for some of the really big pimps, like the, you know, the Chevron pimp and the Lennar pimp and the John Stupid, John Stewart pimp, excuse me, and there's some others. Okay, I do also want to say that again, what we have actually been able to do and what we're actually promoting to other folks right now, on a small scale, is that we practice and we fund what we're doing with what a whole model we call community reparations. The cult of independence that this bullshit capitalist system teaches you, the bootstraps notion and all these other lies, has the situation of the missionary and the gardener and the green and all this shit where no one's talking about what they're coming with. No one's talking about their trust funds, no one's talking about their access, no one's talking about even who they know and how they know. And so we have been able to do that. It's a whole process of teaching, and I just want to say to other poor people-led movements in the group that we teach on that and we're sharing that. Because there are other models besides philanthropimping and nonprofiteering that can actually fund our movement. So I just want to name that. And it also starts with all y'all being honest about where you're walking from and how you're involved and enmeshed and what levels of solidarity / missionary work you're practicing. So I just want to be, you know, that may sound complicated, but for instance, right now, the way our communities are pimped is so high, it's not even funny. And the public housing stock in the whole country is about to be sold on the stock market as mortgages. And so all us poor folks still living in those houses are going to have them completely taken from us and turned into private devil oatments. That's what the crazy shit that's coming down on our head, not to mention food stamp cuts, not to mention the other ways our backs as poor peoples and peoples of color are being broken on the daily. So the other thing is that Dorita talked in the beginning about, Dorita talked in the beginning about the economic piece. I want to name that too. As poor peoples, a lot of us folks in Poor Magazine, we need to get some money on the daily to feed our kids, to actually do the work in the garden, okay? We don't do it for free. Volunteerism is a concept of white supremacy. It's a lie, okay? Who can do that and who can't? And then the other piece of it, we are clearly caught up in the colonization of the bloodstained American dollar still. So we have to not do one or the other, but talk about all of these together. And how there isn't this finite way, and this is the way, or that is the way, but the way of actually speaking about and teaching about these many things. And just not knowing that, please know that, there is another model besides these models. And that's what we're practicing. All transparency, Prensa Pobre, Poor Magazine, no lies, no bullshit about the ways in which bloodstained American dollars are still involved in the work that we do.
We got our friend over here who has a question. You got one. Do you all want to open it up to questions now?
Yeah.
Okay.
Please.
All right. Have Adam.
I'm still giving mine some thought. I'd like for them to go ahead. I'll come after.
All right.
All power to the people. How y'all doing, ladies and gentlemen? Power. All proud to the people. Okay, so it's good to see y'all out here. We came here to join the discussion. Heard the topic was along the lines of gentrification, along the lines of resources and sustainability. And not only speaking on behalf of the Black Riders, but speaking on behalf of the North Oakland neighborhood. I'm from right up the street on Pacific 3rd, not all right around the corner. So I speak on behalf of the community where this is not something that a lot of people very interested in as far as like the Green Revolution or anything that has to do with that. But that's something that has to be changed. And there's certain things that that are attacks on our community, from the healthcare issue, not having accessible healthy foods, from environmental racism, the pollution of our environment due to industrialization and not having access to holistic healthcare alternatives. We have a program where we try to do that, to try to connect the networks. It's an exchange for, of resources for services, because we represent the community, and the people who want to push certain lines, if you don't have community support, it's not going to fly. You just go look like a settler. You're going to look like a gentrifier. You know what I'm saying? It's the neo-colonizers, you know what I'm saying? So if you don't have the community support, it's not really going to last. And then you won't have the protection with the potential of community support, with protection by the community. Don't think just because you got these city ordinances to do certain things that it's going to have a long-term, because they don't have long-term goals. They get paid off for the poverty, you know what I'm saying? So they don't really want to solve the problem. You want to solve the problems, come to the people who really affected by the problems, you know what I'm saying? And come to the people and see what you could do. There's hella vacant lots out here. Hella vacant lots. Are we going to wait to get a ordinance or wait for them to try to clean it up? They ain't going to clean it up, because people owe it and then they got to go through certain things, and you know what I'm saying? They'd rather just use it as a dump spot, you know what I'm saying? And it costs money to do certain things, and that's money that they don't want to spend. The city, all these fucking slumlords out here, you know what I'm saying? So we gotta utilize the community like how they did Jungle Hill, you know what I'm saying? Turn Jungle Hill out there on 38, how they got the community involved with the petitions to come together and say we want this lot to be utilized for a garden, for an urban forestry project, for things of that nature, you know what I'm saying? Because it's things that need it. We gotta kind of ruralize this urbanized society right now, because it's not just on just politics and economical. We're talking about a spiritual connection to people with the earth right now. We're talking about the disturbance of the ecological balance. We're talking about something that's beyond just what we're surrounded by. You know what I'm saying? The earth provides for us, and that's where we go after we reincarnate. So it's not just something that we're looking for a handout. We're looking for an exchange for resources of services. And people who got access to the resources, you got to be able to do that, because right here, being here is a resource. Don't let your presence be a class race antagonism, and that's something that we don't want to happen, because that will stop class struggle, which is what we're about. The Black Rider Liberation Party is about international class struggle within our community, intercommunalism, you know what I'm saying? So that's what we're trying to push. We have the Game Green program, is just a little presentation. Anybody who's interested, you can holler at us, but that's what we want to do with this gentrification. We want issue topic being brought up, we want to bridge the gap between the masses who aren't interested in this type of stuff that need to be reached and enlightened about it. We got access to those type of people who ain't gonna want to be interested in something that don't reflect them. That's what I gotta say about it. So, and on that note, all power to the people, and let's connect it all up. All power to the people.
All power to the people.
All right.
Thank you.
So when I think of wealth and access to education and, you know, and information, I mean, that's something that you're birthed into. So how do we take those things with us, not wanting to take, you know, money from corporations that aren't socially responsible? How do we raise our own resources? How do we look into the power that each one of us has to take the little bit that we have to put into this pool, to consolidate it, to actually create something that is sustainable? not something that we're going to have to go to organizations and foundations consistently asking them for more money, but something that we can build and grow an economy out of. You know, it doesn't make sense to separate, you know, the economics with environmentalism. You know, the very word economy, eco. You know, it's the management of the resources, how we consume what we have, and how we take care of that, and how we build it back up. So what are we doing to create those? And this is a question to everybody on the panel. What are we doing to, because they can give you something. They can give you some land, but how do you pay people to be able to use that land? Are they going to give you that portion of it? Or are they going to give you half of it, and you got to just somehow, you know, come up with the money? Let's just call it what it is, the money, the funding to keep something like that going to where you can... you can create jobs for people that live in that neighborhood so that they're not displaced, so that they have a position to maintain their houses, so that they can have that wealth that's passed on. It's short-sighted thinking to not recognize where the wealth and the privilege and the access came from. You know, it's you can go ahead and start a business, you know, and make a couple mistakes because you have that foundation. Everybody doesn't have that same parachute, you know. So how do we create that economic base? What are you guys doing?
I think the future that you're talking about is related to what's known as the sharing economy, has been thrown out. And that's the economy that exists around cooperatives, mostly, and alternative business structures that allow people to share the resources that they already have. In the regulatory framework, the ability for that to happen doesn't really exist yet. Policies and politicians don't understand. They understand, one, if you're a for-profit company, you're a normal corporation, a small business, they completely understand that, and there's plenty of help for you to be that. They understand if you're a nonprofit, and they understand that you'll like the philanthropy, foundational models, they all understand that. They're like, you have 501c3 status, perfect, we'll give you a grant. Cooperatives, not really. There's not the same institutional framework that allows them to succeed in terms of like financing those things. So I'm starting a cooperative called Energy Solidarity Cooperative, and we become a bridge to help community organizations and institutions achieve renewable funding or renewable energy in a way that can sustain them over time. We believe in the ownership of renewable resources in a distributed way. But the problem is that we're not able to, like, we can't get grants or foundation funds because we're not a 501c3, we're a for-profit business. We don't get loans because, well, we don't really want to interface with the big banks like that. And, you know, cooperatives are something not new, but, like, not mainstream yet. And so, like, banks and different things have a hesitation to kind of... doing that. We're doing what's known as a DPO, and so a DPO is like a direct public offering. So community members actually buy stock into the company, and that's how we end up raising capital. So it's inherently like a community embedded organization, and that's restricted by place. Like that for the DPO, it's restricted by California. And so, like, there's people trying to figure out these sorts of things, and I don't think a really perfect example exists yet. But I don't know, I guess what I have a trouble conceptualizing is the idea that an urban garden is going to sustain us financially. Like, I don't know anyone who grows enough food on an urban garden to pay rent. Real talk. If someone knows one of them, tell me. And that they get all of their money from selling the produce that they put into the labor on their land that they do of an urban garden. Like, I know the some of the immigrant farmers working with the IRC that are trying to move to what's called Wild and Radish. Like, Max was telling me that Pinole Farm, yes. And someone was telling me that a farmer was like, oh, I only need an acre, and I would be able to produce all of what I need to produce. I want to point that out as like an exceptional farmer. You know, like, I want to point that out as a person who has so much knowledge and experience and training that like that's not easily replicable throughout the community. So I don't know. That's what I was talking about in terms of like, will I ever be able to create enough jobs? Like, I don't know if I can create enough jobs through urban gardens, because I don't know if urban gardens are a financially like sustainable thing. But also, I don't know if that's the point for me, right? And so like that's the disconnect that I feel sometimes in my own work. I would like, can I ask you a question, my man? Why do you think the vacant lots persist? No, I was talking to you. As a North Oakland resident, as a person who grew up right here, and you've seen vacant lots, I'm sure, a lot of your life.
All right, so first off, I would like to say that I see that the perspective is narrow financially. From what I'm hearing, I'm thinking of a bigger perspective as far as the healthcare, as far as the access to certain healthy foods, and the type of money we spend on junk. You know what I'm saying? I'm talking about self-sustainability. With being able to grow your own food, it will stop the funding of these, you know what I'm saying, like even the federal league, not the funding, but it'll stop the reliance on, you know what I'm saying, other, these capitalist, Monsanto-based, food corporations, you know what I'm saying? Even the USDA, we know what's gonna happen. They do that. You can't even really like transport raw milk in certain states. So you know they gonna respond. I'm just saying, they gonna respond to your justice of doing for self with fascism. You know what I'm saying? So even if you try to do it financially, you're gonna get attacked by it. Which the most important thing is the people's, the power of the people. We talking about, you talking about economics, the people is the economics. You talk about politics, the people is the politics. Once you just be able to provide for that and do that, then all of that kind of falls into it. I know it might not seem like it's sustainable to make money from it, but think of the money that we spend on that shit that goes to motherfuckers that don't come back to the community tours. You know what I'm saying? I heard a question about the drawing the line over people who we mess with. I heard this the sheriff something brought up. You know, we gotta understand that that's something that don't really meet the people's interests anyway. We know that the police, they only protect private property or privileged property. They don't, just because they make a certain arrest, you know, that don't really make the crime go. Without crime, they won't have no job. So by thinking that you mess with them or having some kind of relationship with them, that you have the Trump side effect over it, I mean, you know, they pimps and players too, and they gonna extort you. So don't think my bad, I'm talking too long.
No, but I just wanted to take you were talking about, you see a lot of vacant lots. So I'm wondering, in your perspective, why don't you think those vacant lots become used by the community?
Because of a lot of race, class, antagonisms towards anything that might be what people could just, based off of perspectives or personal encounters and experiences, some hipster shit. You know what I'm saying? People will just be like, oh, that's something that's not what I'm used to. They're not brought to it. It's not brought to somebody from somebody who they can relate with, you know what I'm saying? And it's important that we do be able to do that, you know what I'm saying? So that's where I think that'll go by. And it's not just the gardens.
Yeah.
We're talking about urban forestry programs too. Everybody got a certain access to some stuff that they have more to give away, you know what I'm saying? We can start planting some of these trees in environments where the air quality is messed up. It gets them, you know, gotta go through the city permits for all of that. You know what I'm saying? And it will grow through food and stuff like that too. You know what I'm saying? You knock out more birds with one stone by having just more self-sustaining light. Forget the grants. We got all the economics and all the networking right here. We just thinking too much where we have to rely on certain things that's not really necessary. They rely on us, really. You know, so.
Hank, did you want to respond? Or are you cool?
Ashoka mentioned or asked, you know, if there's anybody who has a small community garden that sustains themselves, and I don't know the answer to that, probably not, realistically. And I just want to say, for what we do, we've never intended to be a community garden. We don't talk about ourselves as a community garden. We talk about ourselves as a production farm, and our goal is ultimately to produce enough food to feed the 36,000 people that live in our community. Now, I flip that around and say, well, how much money do 36,000 people spend for food every year? And the reality is, in the Bay Area, poor people spend approximately a minimum of $1,000 a year per person to buy food every year, every day, over the course of a year. They're buying food. That translates into our community of 36,000 people into a minimum of $36 million a year. Now, right now, corner store owners take that money, and Safeway and Lucky's and Target and dollar stores and Walmart take that money. I want to take that money. I don't mean me personally. I mean the people in the community. I want the community-owned, worker-owned cooperative to be in a position to produce enough healthy food using organic, sustainable methods to feed the entire community. There's two challenges. One is doing it. It takes a lot. You can plant a lot of food on an acre. Yeah. I can tell you that. The other part is convincing the people who, I'm not talking about North Oakland, I'm talking about where I work. The people in my community, we grow the food, we harvest the food, we pack it, we deliver it, we make it affordable, and people don't buy it. So I have another problem. How do I convince the people in my community to see that as a valuable resource and go to us and not go to Lucky's and Target and dollar stores, et cetera, et cetera?
I gotta jump in.
Please
because
jump.
That is the function of community gardens. And that's why it's so important that the community gardens be run by people from that community. So when you're out there talking about food and getting people involved in food, they are recreating a relationship with food so that when they think of Hank, you know, Dig Deep Farms as where they could get their food from and not Walmart. And they think of it as a valuable thing. Like, that is the function. And if you have somebody who's from that community, you know, talking about, you know, all the benefits of some herb that you're growing or some tomato and creating that relationship, and they've known you forever because you grew up there, then it goes deep and you actually, it is a way to actually build the market. You need to build the market. We need to rebuild the market. People don't eat real food. They eat things that comes in boxes and things in plastic packages and whatnot. And we need to actually take back the market. And that is the function of community gardens. That is where we do that work.
I completely agree. And I'll, may I add a complimentary statement? By the way, we call that stuff that comes in boxes and all that other crap, we call that MESS, which stands for Manufactured Edible Substitute Substance. It's not real food. But the point is, we need that in the soil, hands-on education and learning. I hate the word education even, learning experience that you get from putting your hands in the soil and watching a plant grow and harvesting the tomato or the pepper or whatever it is. In addition, personally, I think we need the smartest, hippest messages on YouTube, on the radio, on billboards, on television. We need to slam our community with messages that say, this is better and healthier and more important for all of us than the crap, the mess that's in the stores.
Just a quick question. Neither here nor there. I just want clarification because I came in late. What exactly is the Sheriff's Department role playing in the work that you guys are doing? I have to ask.
No worries. I work not directly for the Sheriff's Office. I work for a nonprofit organization that was founded by a Sheriff's Office, a sergeant in the Sheriff's Office, who grew up in the community and who came back to the community to be a school resource officer and found that there were none of the things that he had as a kid, like baseball leagues and other things, were there anymore. And he wanted to change that. So he created DCAL, which is like a police athletic league for recreation program. But it's part of a broader crime prevention mission and a restorative justice mission. And for that, his main
strategy, and it's becoming more and more. The sheriff's office strategy for preventing crime and reducing recidivism, keeping people out of jail. And 1/4 of our population comes from Santa Rita, and 1,500 people a year come back into the community from Santa Rita. But to stop that, he wants to create jobs and create wraparound services so that people can become healthy citizens in their own communities again. So there's another mission to the sheriff's office that most people don't know about that personally I think is a valuable resource. It's not about cops beating people up. Yeah?
Where do they get their funding from?
Where does the DSAL get its funding from? We have a variety of different grants and we have grants from like the Kresge Foundation and from the USDA and from San Francisco Foundation and other sources. We deliver food to pregnant women at Tiburcio Vazquez Health Center as part of a healthy food access program for them. We deliver food to Highland Hospital for kids who have childhood obesity so that they have fresh, healthy food, their families do. We were delivering enrichment to the Native American Health Center, but that program ended. We'd like to get it started again. So we manage the grub box with People's Grocery. We're partners with People's Grocery, and we have our CSA in our area as well.
I just wanted to respond to what you said a while back. It was like how, like you pointed out all these limitations of these specific kinds of funding, right? And I think what you really, from what I heard you express for me, was you speaking indirectly about the limitations of nonprofits. And that, I think, is something, it's like a hot topic in Oakland because there's so many nonprofits, but it's still not spoken about enough for me. I think that's precisely the issue. Yes, there are alternatives. There's different methods and models of organization. But I think that aspect, like what your uncle, with I'm sure years of strategic talking to whoever is in power, whoever has access and resources, gets a gift, something that's given to them by the city, right, or by the state, or by, I work at schools, so for me, my big enemy right now is Kaiser, because they're everywhere in open public schools. The big issue for me is not just a short-term versus long-term perspective, but what are the other limitations of nonprofits? You know, like where do we end up when we are so focused on pushing our own organization versus pushing community or pushing for actual change in the neighborhoods that we live in or the communities that we're claiming to serve or to work with? So I get really frustrated when I see organizations only existing for, or nonprofits only existing to keep existing, right? And it's not about whatever our mission statement or our values or our principles are, or what we report to in our different grants that we have to beg for this money, right? And I believe that if somebody's giving you something, then they don't care if you have it or not, right? If somebody's giving you something, then you should be asking for something else, or you should be taking something else without asking, right? And I think that's, for me, is the difference between creating jobs that are sustainable, that are not based on these grant relationships or these funders that are questionable. And yes, we have strategic relationships with them, and I'm not knocking that, but I really think that if we're gonna talk about thinking long term, then we have to be talking about what community looks like and how we can organize ourselves outside of these nonprofits. Because yes, they exist. We're all trying to do wonderful things, but we have to be looking beyond that. And on the community garden tip, I think, and the food tip, I think there's nothing inherently revolutionary about food, I think, or growing your own food. Yes, of course we should be growing our own food because that's how we get food, right? We should be growing our own food, that's a given. But it's an entry point for me into being able to tackle and speak about all these other issues that we are all dealing with, right? So if there's a community garden growing in an empty lot and it's all people that don't actually need that food and they're growing it for somebody else, then I also question the importance of that. But there is an inherent value of food bringing people together, community gardens bringing people together in the sense that we're creating public space. So we're opening up space that exists inside this capitalist private property system for us to build together and to organize together for something larger than what we have currently, right? But I'm really interested in what people have to say about these parklets that have been popping up the last few years or year in Oakland. I wish I was hearing a lot more conversation about them. And in terms of the tack
parklets.
The tack that the city's been taking and what might be the motivations and intentions behind that and the consequences long term.
We have time. It's about 12:50, so we have about 10 more minutes. I have some more questions. We could take questions from the audience, or we could go. Yeah, Johnny's been waiting for a little bit, but or we could talk about maybe next steps that you all could offer folks in the audience, or folks in the audience can maybe provide feedback for the participants and what you all think about how we can now that we've talked about it, how we can take action toward it. So, what do you all think about that?
Okay. I just want to say that. And then I like the next steps.
Next steps? Okay. So it's Tiny and then Ryan and then Victoria.
I just want to say big love to, first of all, to everybody, first just as conscious people, but also big love to our brothers from the Black Riders Liberation Party,
right?
Because, you know, what a lot of us are saying about the fact that, you know, outside of nonprofits and you know, the communities, indigenous communities, in this North Oakland gentrified community, our brother is saying that he is from here. He's right down from here, and he's talking about that disconnect. So to me, if anybody in this community is building a garden, it damn well better be including his scholarship, the communities he's talking to, and our brothers from BLRP. Because this is a rooted African descendant community, be pre-gentrificated, okay? And then the second piece about that is, you know, there are models of non-profiteer movements. First of all, that doesn't disrespect the power of Urban Tilt or our brother Hank or any of the people who are using those. They're doing whatever they can to kind of change the dynamic of corporate pimping. So again, I don't think it's one or the other. I think that we need to get out of this, what's the solution, and it's got to be this way. No, there's many different colors to this, you know, not the rainbow, right, but to this humble walk. And I think that we have to honor that too, you know. Our sister Doria is talking about actually paying poor people to actually grow food in their own community. That's deep. That's hell of deep. When we're up in East O, as gentrificated, you know, members of, you know, the now, as the Paula Trickster said, the crack hoe crew, you know, we are actually growing food. But we realize that there's all this elitism to even be knowing our poor people's even, why shouldn't we eat the Kona Stove food? You know, so we accept food stamps, as we're gonna be starting to do and doing a free stand. But right now we do what we call harm reduction hot dogs, where we actually give, you know, the healthy non-GMO hot dogs because people understand hot dogs right now. And then you can put a little salad on the plate and start a conversation about that came from the garden. So let's stop coming into these communities and acting like everybody knows that we should all be growing our food. No, we don't. You know, let's back up. We've been colonized and food stampized and food co and slave wayized for a long ass time. And that goes back to my critique of the, you know, the elitist composters. I mean, come on. You know, I'm still figuring it out. All of us poor mamas, we have the project called the Welfare Queens, that's small W capital Q. I'm also very real about the fact that my melanin challenge self. My mom is black, but I look like my colonizer dad. Who should be talking to my community members but people who look like them and be like them and walk like them, right? So that's another piece of it. Let's talk about race. Let's bring that shit out. That's real. You know, you're talking about poor communities of color. You're talking about the Raza community out that Hank's talking about. He's talking about that there's a lot of people who understand food production as a job. That's, he just said that. Okay? That means that when we relate it to economics, it was a way to cause a teaching moment. Okay, we're talking about black communities. We need to be talking, essentially having the leadership be there. Okay? Let's be very real about these pieces. They've already been named and spoken about. And lastly, you know, Porn Magazine has a landless people strategy that is not non-profiteered and philanthropimped. And if you, and we're Poe. Porn Magazine is Poe. We don't got no money, and we're always struggling. We're struggling on welfare, food stamps, and the like. So if any of y'all want to kick down some cash, we would appreciate it. Right now, I'm not doing my hustle, so I could be here. So I'm just saying that. www.poormagazine.org.
I wanted to bring up what you said about how much food can be grown, and it brought to mind, I was wondering if anyone else. Homestead Farm in Pasadena, where they grow like 6,000 pounds on a tenth of an acre, something like that. The family says that they eat like 90% of the food they grow right on the tenth of an acre. They also sell a bunch of it, so there is that income from it. It makes me think of Cuba, where like after the collapse happened and all these people were hungry in the cities, they started taking over every square inch of soil and planting food in them and growing food together. And now they grow around 70%, but like somewhere between 60 to 80% of the food that's eaten in the two largest cities in Cuba is grown in those cities. And so like what it brings to me is kind of what I think you're getting at, which is that as long as these dominant systems exist, it's never going to be enough. Like, what we're going to be able to sell of the produce that we can grow isn't ever going to be enough. But once we throw off these dominant systems, once we don't have to pay rent anymore because the banks that own our houses can't enforce their ownership of those houses through the police, once we throw that off of us, then we can feed ourselves with the food that we're growing on these lots, and we can live in these houses, and we can create these alternative structures. We don't need to think about how much income we're going to make from them, because we don't need to pay someone that's still owning everything that we live within. So like that's what it brings up for me. I'm wondering how other people feel about that. It's much more of like a long-term strategy, and I recognize and I appreciate everything we're doing in the now to survive and struggle and like keep ourselves well and healthy with the system that's in place right now. But I think keeping that like longer-term vision, like throwing those things off of us, is important, because once we do that, we'll be able to grow what we need and build what we need and create what we need with our own hands. We don't have to worry about it not being enough.
So Doria, I'm going to come in, and it has to do with that and a little something to bring back with the question. Just really quick. I think that folks in progressive movements oftentimes think battle to battle. They don't have as a whole, don't have long-term plans. You know, a long-term plan is like a five-year, three-year. I think that we need to be thinking in multiple generations, and that we're basically just in this as peoples, you know, to maintain a high quality of life and to create a high quality of life for our peoples, like seven generations peoples. You know, like this is not about one little battle here and one little battle there. I think we need to also be working on a short-term plan, because people have real needs right now. They need food now, and they need shelter now. So having both things working at once, and not sacrificing one for the other. In Richmond, I struggle on the kind of things that I'm in terms of my political life, on making sure that we're maintaining, you know, a transition plan that's a 20, 30, 50 year, 100 year plan. And that we're not afraid of that, that we understand things are going to happen over time if we're talking about whole systems change. On that same front, I think that we need to be using all tools. Like, a carpenter shouldn't only use his hammer. You know, there's many tools that a carpenter needs to use. So nonprofits are one tool. Crowdfunding, co-ops are another tool. These are all tools, and they all need specific circumstances to be very successful. I think we need to understand the purpose for each tool really clearly. I think that our error with nonprofits has been thinking that they are to maintain programs. I think that's wrong. I think that nonprofits shouldn't be to maintain programs, they should be to transfer wealth. We should be getting money through nonprofits to build capital, to actually make assets, to actually acquire assets for communal ownership. That's what we should be using nonprofits for, not the day-to-day running of programs. I think that's how we burn up the money, and we don't actually sink the resources and as an asset into the community. And I've made that mistake, you know, in the nonprofit that I run, trying to figure out how to correct it now. I think that the programs that we should run shouldn't be these programs. Like, where do we get this idea of programs, that we need to do these abstract things that people get paid for? You know, people have needs, and our programs should be going to actually serving those needs directly. And in the way that we serve those needs, we should be doing political education, critical thinking, whatever. But we should actually be filling needs. You know, people need childcare. People need to be able to move from point A to point B without having to pay a hell of a lot of money. You know, that we can serve. People need their houses fixed. People need, you know, electricity. We can serve all of these real needs and do it in a way where consciousness, education, person-to-person education is the method that we do it. And I think that we get caught up in this other education system where we're supposed to be in abstract environments spending time. That's really a luxury. And in paying ourselves for this luxury to run and deliver programs, and what it does is it takes what we should be using to sink assets and burns it up, so we're left with nothing. So we're left with nothing in the end, right? So you can send $10 million through Richmond and it all just gets flushed in the end because none of the assets were sunk. I think that we need to look at each one of the tools that we have at hand and figure out what's the best use of that tool. Urban Tilth can only be as powerful as what we're able to do in terms of political education in the gardens, in terms of getting people to build this new market, and at the same time, how we can gain access to larger plots of land and learn from people like Hank Herrera or, you know, Growing Power to grow real amounts of food so that we can supply our own need. Like, we need to be working on both fronts. And cooperatives seem to be a really great tool in order to, you know, if somebody's going to be using their time to fill a need, you know, that they are, you're returning the most of that exchange to the person and to the community. That seems to be the best tool to employ people, you know? So how do we use these tools, you know, the best tools to transfer wealth and actually sink them and not burn it up? You know, we need to be thinking more complexly and using all the tools necessary, you know, so that we can move on that 100-year plan, on that 50-year plan. We need to be, you know, transferring wealth now, building assets now, getting the 3 acres in the land trust, the 10 acres in the land trust, whatever, you know, building the people's capacity to participate as meaningful, you know, co-op members. That's a whole other issue. Like, people need to have skills so that they're equal members in a co-op, you know? I mean, it's a complex question. And there's like, anyway, my point is that we need to be thinking more detailed, more deeply, using all of our tools in our toolbox, and not saying, oh, I hate hammers, or, you know, saws suck, I'm only about, you know, cutting with my whatever. You know, like, we need to figure out what's the best use for each thing and using it appropriately.
All right. Well, it looks like we're about out of time. Unless you all are feeling like you want to keep having this conversation, I'm down, but I want to respect everybody's time. We good? Do you have one last thought, Shoka?
One last thought. I guess it's I definitely agree with what everything that has been said. And it's, to me, an example of the way that we bring our own life experiences and values and norms to the work that we do, and the way that we make that relevant for ourselves and we do what resonates with us. I'm wondering broadly, with all of us, how do we really start connecting that work? How do we really start making that work move forward as a network where we have people who are doing, using our above ground tools, you know, covertly supporting the underground tools, and how did the underground tools then come and support the above ground tools, and how do we create this dynamic mutualistic relationship? Because we do really need all the ways. We need all of them, all of the ways. Like, I was talking to the scientist at UC Berkeley, and he does remediation for Chevron, and he's trying to remediate a bunch of land for Chevron. Like, we need Chevron to remediate land too, you know? Like, we need them to clean up their own fucking messes, you know what I mean? Like, we need all of the ways, because this situation has gotten so bad. But I do wanna talk about the idea that, like, social change in this country and the history of social change in our civilization is rooted in people who didn't have anything taking what they wanted. Like, the real history of this country is direct radicalism. If it was slavery, it was escaping. If it was workers, it was striking. And somehow along the way that changed. And somehow, I think what people were speaking to in terms of, and what gets said about the nonprofit, is that the nonprofit has become the barrier between radical movements and institutional change in a way that the middle class is the barrier between poor people and rich people in the context of civil class war. It's a really apt analogy, right? And so how do those two institutions of the middle class and the NGO, because that's what we're talking about when we're talking about greening and gentrification, right? We're not talking about rich people coming in. We're talking about middle class people coming in that have relative privilege, and, you know, NGOs. And so how does that buffer social change, right? And so how does it create situations like this where we have a panel and all of you, most of you we haven't talked to, you guys aren't necessarily talking to each other, you're all looking at us. Like, does that actually create social change? I don't know, I've been on a lot of panels, I've seen a lot of panels, I've been in your situation. Has it really made that much of a difference? I don't know. But I think it's the question we need to ask ourselves. Is the model that we talk to each other actually reinforcing the norms that we have of these are the leaders of what we do and we are just the peons? I think we should ask ourselves those questions honestly. I know, I'm not trying to belittle what you're saying.
And the hope is that people are going back with the ideas to their own communities and thinking about the ideas, and probably, you know, what if the people who are working in nonprofits say, hey, what if we stop funding our programs and start making assets that are help communally within the community?
That's
with
dope.
This money that we get. Like, from now on, no more running programs, and only the programs are funded by whatever direct service we can offer to the community, you know, like, and re-challenging funds. Like, that's where the power of a gathering like this can happen, is in what actions you all do and we all do when we leave and go back to our communities. Like, that's where the power is.
One more thing I just want to add to that is what he said as far as, like, next steps and this, that, and the third. Let's just make sure that after this, it doesn't just break off. Make sure we personalize after we get public, like, you know what I'm saying? Everybody should interact personally so we can actually know what people stand for, instead of being shy, or instead of not understanding, what, you know, or just hearing by word of mouth. Come ask, you know what I'm saying? And I'm gonna leave it at that.
And I also wanna say that it takes a lot to unpack your personal privilege and begin the revolution at home and itself. We do a thing called People School, so it's not too late to register for the fall semester.
All right.
Check us out.
All right, well, on the final note, as Tiny mentioned earlier, a lot of these folks are taking their time away from their weekends. They worked all week for very low, oftentimes nonprofit wages, and to come here and provide education that's been circulating through their histories and their families' histories for decades, and to have this conversation. And a lot of us here at Fat Beats are also volunteers, and so we just want to recognize that the revolution is funded by the people, and like we're talking about, even within the society, we need funds to do the work that we're doing here today, and we're not going to be shy about that. So if y'all have a moment, visit Urban Tilth's website, make a donation if you can, allow them to keep doing that really important work in Richmond, putting the pressure on Chevron to get the hell out, maybe eventually, hopefully. Tiny and Poor Magazine are doing amazing work out in East Oakland. If you could check them out, is it poormagazine.org? Poormagazine.org, think about making a donation or becoming a monthly sustainer. Fat Beats Produce, we're currently being pushed out of this space. I don't know if you all know about that situation, but that's part of that urban greening that we're doing with gardens and healthy food and farmers markets that is leading to it becoming a more attractive space for the community and newcomers. And we're currently being gentrified out, essentially, by the business inside called Greasebox. And to help us find a new space, we're gonna need money and funds to keep having farmers markets and to keep doing the programs that we're doing today. Of course, Hank Herrera taking the time to come out and doing the work with Dig Deep Farms, and Marika, who works 6 days a week, to be here packing the CSA with all a bunch of other volunteers. This takes our resources, time, and money, and we want you all to be supportive of this as we are supportive of this work here in Oakland. So think about making a contribution, and let's give the panelists a round of applause for their work today.